Well, thank you for your welcome. It's a joy to be here. I can't say once again, I've been to Australia before, but not to this part of Australia. I do apologize for the tone of my voice. You're not getting some nice, soft, dulcet English tones this morning. My voice is very husky. I think I picked up some bug on the plane coming over. Those air conditioning systems tend to circulate all sorts of bugs, and I've ended up with a cold. This is the best I feel today, so I'm glad and thankful to God for his mercies. But I bring the greetings of the church in Maidenbower, in Crawley. Any of you come over to England, you're welcome. We're about 20 miles south of London. By all means, get in touch with us and pay us a visit. We'll be very happy to see you and have you spend some time with us. Now, I want to spend some time with you today looking at Hezekiah, his faith and his folly. We're going to begin with, if we have the passage open in front of us that we were just reading, we're going to be looking specifically in a moment at verses 14 to 19. But let me begin with a question. How does a man who aspires to be a man of God cope with the pressures of living in a world that in one way or another constantly seeks to assault and to undermine your godliness? And in that world, I would include Satan, because he is the prince of this world. And we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places. Living in the 21st century as we do, we're living in a complex and challenging context. We are bombarded daily by messages, by products, by advertisements, by entertainment, by internet chatter, iPods, iPads, smartphones, hundreds of TV channels. Culture is personified often in the lifestyles of rugged sportsmen, pop stars, and film stars. If you are a Christian man, then you are a God-appointed leader in your home. It is men who are appointed to lead in the Church of Jesus Christ. You are called to walk a life of integrity and influence, and to show degrees of leadership where you work, depending on your particular role, but you are called to be a man of integrity. Men who adorn the doctrine of God our Savior in all things, and who are zealous for good works. Now, I doubt if any of you who are Christians would disagree with that, but the question is, how? Well, I suppose you could do what people do and say, well, the best way is to beat a retreat pretty quick. We'll go and be monks somewhere and retreat somewhere and cut ourselves off from the world. Well, I think most of you are aware that that's a stupid path to take, because you are subject to the same pressures, because they arise from in there, not sent out there. I am persuaded, as I'm sure many of you are, that the word of God is sufficient to equip us as men of God, to thoroughly equip us for every good work, to live our lives and fulfill our God-intended roles in this world. I'm further persuaded that we can go back even 700-800 years before the birth of Jesus Christ and learn from the faith and, sadly, from the folly of King Hezekiah. He faced a crisis. The crisis was in the form of Sennacherib and Assyria. Assyria was the great, growing, dominant world empire. And as we read here in chapter 19, Sennacherib was basically swallowing up everything in his path. Hezekiah, and was Judah going to be swallowed up? And if not, why not and how not? How was he going to stand against such might and such power? Now, we have three sources in our Bibles for the life of Hezekiah. We have 2:18-20. And as Troy mentioned, we also have Chronicles, 2 Chronicles 29-32. But we also have a third source in Isaiah, chapters 36-39. Now we're going to focus for simplicity on 2 Kings, but I will refer from time to time to 2 Chronicles and Isaiah, because there are some parts that cast light on each other. That's the way to handle the Bible anyway, isn't it? We get light from different passages. Let me first of all this morning give you some idea about this man Hezekiah. I want to seek to persuade you that Hezekiah was an exceptional man in his day. And then we will go on secondly to look at the fact that he was an exceptional man of faith in his day. Those are my 2 points. The second one will be the longer one, and we'll look at this prayer of Hezekiah. But Hezekiah, first of all, was an exceptional man in his day. I mean, he stood out among his contemporaries, but he also stood out among his predecessors and his successors. You remember it says that you could recognize Saul among his contemporaries. He was head and shoulders above them. Put him in a group, oh, you could pick out Saul because he was so much taller than him. Well, spiritually, Hezekiah was head and shoulders above his contemporaries and his predecessors and successors. There are 2 testimonies about him that are consistent with that conclusion. We read in 2 Chronicles 29-31 a summary of the reforms that the young Hezekiah carried out in order to bring about the true worship of God in Jerusalem and in the temple. If we turn to 2 Chronicles 31, you'll just get a summary of that, which you won't find in Kings. Summary, chapter 31, verse 20-21. Thus Hezekiah did throughout all Judah, and he did what was good and right and true before his God. And in every work that he began in the service of the house of God, in the law and in the commandment, to seek his God, he did it with all his heart. So he prospered. Now, I haven't time to expound that. It's worthy in and of itself. But he did what was good, what was right, and what was true before God. And he was unusual in his day. And then in 2 Kings chapter 18 and verses 5, 6, again you have a summary. And here you get this message that he was exceptional, very clearly portrayed. Verse 5, he trusted in the Lord God of Israel, so that after him was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor who were before him. He held fast to the Lord. He did not depart from following him, but kept his commandments which the Lord had commanded Moses. The Lord was with him. He prospered wherever he went, and he rebelled against the king of Assyria and did not serve him. If we can try and summarize those summaries, what was it that made this man exceptional? It was because of his priorities. Here was a man of God who was devoted to serving God, to doing what was good and right and true before God. They were biblical priorities. Here was a man who obeyed the commandments of God. Here was a man whose heart was set on serving God, on submitting to his word. He was faced with idolatry. He was faced with the vile pagan practices of Baal worship. He was faced with astrology, black magic, necromancy, the attempts to play the political games of the day and to offset one power against another. But this man stood his ground. The first thing that he did when he became king, and he was only a young man, was he set about changing the worship. Who was his father? Ahaz. And Ahaz was not a faithful, God-fearing. Ahaz was responsible for all kinds of perversions of worship. He had made his children pass through the fire. Hezekiah was a survivor in the grace of God. He sacrificed on all the high places. He was at odds with Isaiah the prophet. You read in Isaiah chapter 7 of those things. When he went to Damascus, he took a liking to a particular altar that he saw there in the temple. And he had it copied and brought back and had the altar in the temple of God removed and in its place. He had no care. And Hezekiah was brought up under this man. This was his father. It tells you something about his character. Because when he became king, the first thing he did was to throw all this stuff out. Why? Because he was a man after God's own heart. His great-great-grandfather, David. You will be, and you will continue to be, a faithful man of God, only in so far as you personally maintain the same biblical priorities, the same principles, the same practices. Now, our situation is different, obviously, to Hezekiah, but the principles are no different. That man's choices, man's decisions, that man's actions were informed decisions, choices, and actions. And they were informed by the Word of God, insofar as he had the Word of God, the law of Moses, and so on. He was successful. He prospered. The Lord blessed him. Why? Because he was a man after God's own heart. But having said that, Hezekiah set out on this path. He began well. But then the Lord often sends severe tests to our faith. And the prosperity then is put to the test. And when we turn in 2 Kings 19 to see the second thing now, we see his faith, because secondly, he was an exceptional man of faith in his day. We take now the zoom lens of our camera and look at this one incident. There in verse 14, we read that Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. We read about the contents of that letter. Basically, Sennacherib was saying, you're finished. I am going to come and destroy Judah and Jerusalem. And he did it in such a way that he was full of boasting, full of arrogance, full of blasphemy, derisory. It would have been frightening. It would have been frightening. I think Hezekiah would have trembled when he read this. I think I certainly would. Wouldn't you? Though he trembled, he did not panic. Immediately, didn't even consult with Isaiah, and he often did. Immediately he knew what to do. He went into the temple, and he took the letter and laid it out before the Lord. Now, let's remind ourselves, Sennacherib was a real threat. Samaria, the northern 10 tribes, had already gone into captivity. They were already under Assyria's rule. Sennacherib was right with regard to what had happened to all the other nations. His reasoning was wrong, but he was right in the sense that what he said had happened to the other nations had happened. They'd just fallen. He had destroyed. They have been taken off into captivity. What do you do when you face crises? Do you panic? Do you seek the help of men? Is that your first port of call? Do you rely on your own abilities? Your own wit? Your own wisdom? Perhaps you're a bit of a control freak. And you think, well, I can handle this situation if I do this and manipulate that and do a bit here and poke a bit there and there. Or if you've got financial means, you think, well, I can pay my way out of this. I can use some financial influence and clout. Or you can rely on your power of personality. Well, none of those things are going to work, are they? What did Hezekiah do? What should I do when we face crises in our lives and in the life of the church of Jesus Christ? Because fundamentally, remember, Hezekiah is king over the people of God. And the future of the church of Jesus Christ is at stake at this point. Because Hezekiah stands in the line from which our Lord Jesus Christ will one day come. He is in the line of the house of David. What does he do? He turns immediately. You say, well, that's not very profound. No, it isn't. But how often in a crisis we don't do that? We panic. But he turned to God. Are you the kind of man who, when you face similar crisis, are you a man of faith who turns to the Lord? Are you a man who has a firm and solid faith in God? As we look at verses 14 to 19, try and demonstrate to you how Hezekiah was that kind of man. There are four things about his faith. We're trying to establish that he was an exceptional man of faith. Well, in what ways? Firstly, as a man of faith, he spreads out his helplessness before the Lord. He went up to the house of the Lord, verse 14, and spread it before the Lord, and then he prayed before the Lord, and so, O Lord God of Israel, and so on. He receives the letter, he reads it, he consults no one. He goes up immediately into the temple, the house of the Lord, the place of God's dwelling among his people. If you like, the throne of grace, the mercy seat, where God dwells among his people. He spreads the letter before the Lord. Of course, the Lord knows the contents. He knows exactly what it says. But Hezekiah comes and lays the letter before the Lord because that letter says everything. Because what effectively he is doing is he lays that letter out, Lord, I can't do anything. My back is against the wall. I cannot do anything to withstand this man. And by laying out, he is spreading out all his helplessness and all his weakness before God. And that is what faith does. Faith lays out your weakness and dependence upon God. That's the beginning of real prayer. When you turn to God and you say, Lord, I'm in a hole. There's nothing I can do. I can't resolve this. I don't have the power. I don't have the wisdom. I don't have the ability. I don't have the guts to do any of this. He comes then in total reliance on God. He's saying, as a king, well, I've got all those treasures, but all the treasures I've got and all the military might that I possess, they will not be sufficient to withstand this threat. Now, when I'm at home and I'm preaching, I've spent a lot of time over the last few years preaching through these Old Testament historical books. And there's a phrase that's now familiar with the people there. We come across a passage in the Bible, and I have titled it, Uh-oh Passage. By that I mean, you get someone like Sennacherib coming along, or a Goliath, and they start opening their big mouth and boasting what they are going to do to God's people. And the more you hear this, you say, uh-oh, you're in trouble. You are in real trouble. Do you really know what you are doing as you, your boastings and your arrogance against the Lord? You are throwing down the gauntlet. You are throwing down a direct challenge to the God of heaven. You haven't got a clue what you're doing. You haven't got a clue what the consequences are. But as a child of God reading these things, you say, uh-oh, this is trouble. This man is going to meet an ungodly end unless he repents. And the irony is, in this situation, as Sennacherib comes with all his boasting, with all his arrogance and all his blasphemies against the living God, what does he actually do? He drives Hezekiah to God. He drives him and he draws near to God. And by doing so, he is sealing his own destruction. And there's a sense in which you can laugh at the folly and the arrogance that raises its fist in the face of God. But here is where prayer then really begins. It's that sense of helplessness, and you are casting yourself upon God. You're saying, Lord, you are my strength. I don't have the resources to handle this situation. In New Testament terms, think of the words in Hebrews chapter 4. You're going to Jesus, your great high priest. You're going to the throne of grace. And why are you going there? To receive grace and mercy to help in time of need. And you come and you speak openly. You come and you speak confidently about your needs. You pour out your heart to the one who is enthroned at the hand of the Father. And you tell him what your needs are. That's, in Old Testament terms, in New Testament terms, what Hezekiah was doing in Old Testament terms. He was coming to the mercy seat. He was coming to the throne of grace. And he was holding out this letter. Lord, it's up to you. I can do nothing. And that's the posture of prayer. Prayer is casting yourself upon God. The problems that you face, crises that in your family, in your home, perhaps ungodly teenagers, perhaps even an ungodly wife, relatives who make it hard for you, people at work who make it hard, other pressures you feel overwhelm you. What do you do? How do you maintain your faith? Well, you come to the Lord and you say, I can't handle this. I don't have the power, the ability, the wisdom, the wit, the resources to do this thing, and I'm casting myself upon you. That's the first step. That's the first way in which faith manifests itself. The second way is, as a man of faith, he has a lofty view of God. A lofty view. Notice how he addresses God in verse 15. O Lord God of Israel, the one who dwells between the cherubim, you are God. You alone of all the kingdoms of the earth, you have made heaven and earth. Now, there's not a word in here yet about his petition. The petition comes right at the end of his prayer. He doesn't start, save us, deliver us. He starts, having cast himself upon God, you realize who this God is now, that he's casting himself. Hezekiah knows the greatness and the glory of his God. He knows his God. How you think of God, how you address God, in one sense, is the most important thing about you. And the most important thing about your faith. Because your faith is a faith in God, is it not? So who is this God to whom Hezekiah is praying? And your faith, you see, will be as small or as great as your knowledge and understanding and appreciation of who God is. The greater your knowledge of God, the greater will be your faith. And I would say that he is a great man of faith because he has a great view of God, a lofty and elevated view of God. He first of all is persuaded that God is the God who is near. He is the one who dwells between the cherubim. We often think of God dwelling in the highest heavens, and that is right. But he's in the temple. Why has he gone into the temple? Because that's the dwelling place of God on earth. That is the point where God has drawn near. And that's so where he goes. You are the one who dwells among your people. You are the one who has drawn near to us. You are the one who hears our cries because you draw near to us. Perhaps he remembered the prayers of Solomon when the temple was first dedicated. You remember those words in 1 Kings? Great, there's a long chapter there. Let me just read one or two verses. Perhaps because Hezekiah was a man of the book, the scriptures, he would draw on these things. Because that was the way he derived his knowledge of God anyway. Verse 37, when there is a famine in the land, pestilence or blight or mildew, locusts, grasshoppers, when their enemy besieges them in the land of their cities, wherever plague is, whatever sickness there is, whatever prayer, whatever supplication is made to by anyone or by all your people in Israel, when each one knows the plague of his own heart and spread out his hands toward this temple, then hear in heaven your dwelling place and forgive and act. I'm tempted to think that he was modeling himself on Solomon, taking what Solomon had said and done on that day and putting it into practice. Because Hezekiah would have known those things. He had the scriptures. He was a man who followed after David and after Solomon. And consequently, he would have been a man who would have known those verses. So he comes to the temple where God is enthroned among the cherubim. But God has drawn near. But then he also has an understanding of the God who is vast in his sovereign power. And that's something that the other religions of this world cannot grasp. How God can be near and yet great. The God of the Muslim, Allah, is distant. He never gets really involved with you. The gods of the nations are useless. Remember how Elijah sarcastically portrayed Baal. The prophets were calling their gods. And he says, call a bit louder, shout a bit louder, cut yourselves a bit more. Hey, perhaps he's gone on a journey. Perhaps he's gone to have a meditate. Perhaps he's even gone to relieve himself. It's that crude. That's his sarcasm. They're useless. Hezekiah knows his God. He is near, but he is vast in sovereign power. He says here, you are God. You and you alone, verse 15, of all the kingdoms of the earth. You see what he's saying? Here's Assyria. Here's Assyria in all its might and power. Here's this boasting, arrogant, big mouth. And he puts the God who draws near and the God who is the God over all the nations of the world between himself and Sennacherib. And puts Sennacherib then in. Faith does that. Faith puts the problem into perspective. Sennacherib wants to fill Hezekiah's fears and fill his horizons. But the man of faith fills his horizons and vision with God and his greatness. God in his condescension as he draws near to his people, and God in his greatness as the one who is over all the nations. He's the creator. You've made heaven and earth. You remember how David said in Psalm 33, You spoke, and it was done. You commanded, and it was accomplished. It stood fast. So he comes to the God who is to hear the cries of his people. He comes to God who has drawn near to his people and is the helper of his people. But at the same time, he's coming to God in all his greatness. Mighty in power, massive in power, far greater than Sennacherib. He alone is the creator of the heavens and earth. How else could Hezekiah overcome fear, panic, and threat? Faith in this God is the only answer. What better way to build up your faith and confidence in God than to dwell upon the fact that God condescends to draw near and to hear the cries of his people? And then, without dismissing that, secondly, to call upon this God who is absolute in his sovereignty, who has power beyond our wildest imagination. You see, as you understand and as you believe and trust in and grow in knowledge of this God, that builds up your hope, that builds up your confidence, that builds up your assurance, that builds up your faith in God. And so you are able to rely upon him more and more to help you and to deliver you. That makes sense? Of course it does. Does that come naturally to you? Uh-uh. It doesn't, does it? There are sometimes you can feel a man of faith one day, and the next day it's evaporated. A new crisis comes and you've got to work it out all again. You could go through the whole thing all over again. That's how fickle and weak we are. That's why I say, when he gets this letter, he doesn't have to think about it. He goes straight into the temple and lays out this letter and calls upon his God. And that means then, thirdly, having cast himself in his helplessness upon God, having had this lofty view of God, he's in a position as a man of faith to earnestly lay hold upon this God and to ask him to do something. But you see the progression in his prayer. This is not the first thing that he does. Well, prayer changes things. I've always had a problem with that statement. I think what people mean when they say that is, psychologically it's good for you, because it's a way of releasing all your pent-up emotions and feelings. Well, it's not a very good statement. It's not a very careful statement. Prayer, rather, lays hold of God who changes things. That's the difference. Prayer lays hold of God. And listen to how Hezekiah now lays hold of God. Verse 16, incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, see, and hear the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to reproach the living God. Truly, Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste the nations and their lands. What he said is true. They've cast their gods into the fire. They were not gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore, they have destroyed them. But he's pleading now with God. He's earnestly laying hold of God. He's appealing to God's ears and God's eyes. Lord, you've heard. Lord, you've seen. This man has come. He's reproached you. He's blasphemed against your name. And that's the real issue. The real issue is not simply we need to be saved because of Sennacherib knocking at our doors, laying siege to our walls. The real issue is this man has blasphemed your name. This man is attacking, and in his zeal and in his faith, he wants God to act for his own name's sake. And if that means then that they will be saved, that will be the way in which God will be glorified. But his first concern is with the glory of God. Notice those words. He doesn't incline your ear, open your eyes, hear the words which he said about the destruction of Jerusalem, to reproach the living God. Lord, this man has never faced the living God. But Hezekiah is calling upon the living God to act and to defend his name and his glory and his honor and deal with this big mouth Sennacherib. But you see now where all Hezekiah's energy is running, all his adrenaline is running. It's not in running wild in despair, in panic, turning here, turning there, every direction in a complete flap. All his energy, it's intense, but it is next upon God and earnestly laying hold of God. All his energy, all his sweat and toil, all his emotions are channeled into this earnest plea. I have no doubt that when he laid himself there before God, he sweated, he quivered, he shivered, he toiled. This was no cold exercise of faith. When he cast himself upon God, he was in earnest. But it was the quivering, the sweat oil of faith. A man who trusted in God. Now, when Hezekiah said, "Incline your ear, open your eyes," did he think God didn't know? That God didn't hear? Well, of course not. But that is a mark, that's an index of his intensity, his conviction, his confidence. He believed that God had been greatly offended, his name had been blasphemed and dragged down into the dust, and the reputation of God, the gods of the nations. And there was also in Hezekiah's faith a jealousy, an anger, a resentment because of this man's arrogance. And that added to his intense faith and added to his pleas. So having cast himself in his helplessness upon God, having focused his understanding of God, this lofty views of God, having earnestly laid hold of God, then he comes to the plea. "Now therefore, Lord our God," verse 19, "I pray, save us from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you are the Lord God, you alone." Supposing that's all of the prayer of Hezekiah. "Now, O Lord our God, I pray, save us from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you are the Lord God alone." It's lost all its power. It's lost all its purpose. It's a bullet, but you can't fire it. It's an arrow, but you can't shoot it. That kind of petition comes only as a consequence of all the things that have gone before. Climax to his prayer. Take that plea, and it has no force in and of itself. But the request is simple. The request is earnest. "God, save us, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you alone are the Lord God, you alone." When you face a crisis like that and you get things properly in focus, it kind of makes your pleas urgent and simple and direct. It is, isn't it, in every other situation in life. If you run into a problem, what do your children do? They cry out, "Help! Mum, Dad, where are you?" And you hear that cry, you come running. They don't sit down and start formulating some statement and some roundabout sentences, they just yell, they just cry out because of the urgency of the situation. And that's what Hezekiah is in effect doing. But he's doing it only as he has cast himself upon God, only reminded himself who this great God is, only as he has earnestly laid hold of him, then he makes his specific request. He has one eye on his troubles, one eye on Jerusalem and the threat to the city, but his other eye is on God's glory in the world. He wants Assyria to know, all the nations to know, there is one true and living God. And if you are a man of faith, what are your concerns? What are your concerns? Are they not for the Church of Christ and for the reputation of God in this world? Isn't that what Hezekiah is effectively praying for? He's praying for the future of the kingdom. He's praying for the people of God. He's praying for the city of God as it was represented on earth at that time. But he's praying above all else that God, who is the living God, that his name will be glorified in all the earth. Not just Assyria, but all the nations will know that there is only one God. That's the man of faith that he was. He was an exceptional man, but an exceptional man of faith. And what you have here in verses 14 and 19 is a window into the heart of this man. And a window into understanding what faith is and how faith expresses itself in prayer. Now, briefly and just by way of conclusion, let me try and draw out one or two threads. If you're to be a man of God and a man of true faith, notice here, you don't need something new. Something different. The Christian world always seems to be throwing up some new latest fad or fashion that's going to resolve this, that and the other problem. Men of God, go back to the Word of God. Men of God, men of faith, learn how to be like Hezekiah prayed, laying hold of God. That's the first thing I think that we need to remind ourselves. The second thing is that as men of God, first and foremost, your concern and my concern is to be for the glory of God as we go through various crises and changing circumstances and events. Your eyes are eyes that ought to be upon Christ and his church and his kingdom and the prosperity of the cause of Christ in this world. And there are many setbacks. You read through the book of Acts, and what do you find? Stephen dies. One of the leading men dies. He's stoned to death. You move on a few more chapters, James dies. Peter's taken prison. And it looks as if he's going to die. But of course he remarkably escapes. And as you read through the book of the Acts of the Apostles, you see persecution upon persecution. Through nations we shall enter the kingdom of God, says the Apostle Paul to one of the early churches. And you read through your church history, it's the same story. But you see, what is to be your utmost concern in the midst of those changing scenes and certain events and crises? You plow a straight furrow as a man of faith, as a man of God. Your concern is first and foremost for the glory of God in his church. And there will be times when it looks as if things are not going to work out that way. I wonder what some people thought when Stephen died, when James died. I would imagine there were some people who thought, that's it. Now, we're not given all the insights into that. But the important thing is that we can, on as men of God, even when things do not seem to work out according to our expectations. Nowhere in the Bible does God promise to deliver us from every temporal evil. I can't guarantee that if you pray like this in a crisis, you'll get a similar answer to what Hezekiah did. I can't do that. But that doesn't alter the fact that you stay and remain as a man of faith. The third thing is this. Let me ask you in closing. How well do you know your God? How well do you know him? Could you call upon him in this kind of way? If you're aspiring to be a man of God, aspiring to be a man of faith, then you have to imitate Hezekiah. Hezekiah was a man of God who knew God because he knew God's word. The whole purpose of God giving us the scriptures is not so we merely have factual information about what happened in the history of his kingdom. It's in order that we might know him and know his power and know his mercy and learn increasingly to cast ourselves upon him. He was an exceptional man, this king. Paul wasn't an exceptional man as an apostle of Jesus Christ. But the greatest of men, the greatest of kings, and the greatest of apostles turn beggars when they come and cast themselves upon God. To cast themselves upon God at the throne of grace. There are times when we live on the brink of catastrophe. Times when we live on the brink of crisis and we don't know where to turn. We turn to God. And we trust him. And our soul is firmly anchored in him. That was the lesson that we learned from this man Hezekiah in this instance. And he is worthy of your imitation. He's a pattern for us as a man of God, as a man of faith. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you for the Holy Scriptures. We thank you for the things that you've given us, the things that you have taught us. Lord, make us men of the Scriptures. Make us of biblical priorities, obedient hearts, holding fast to you. Above all, make us men of faith, men of prayer, who know what it is to lay hold of you each day of our lives, and especially in times of crisis. Lord, we look to you. We have no one else. You are our help. You are our strength. You are our God. We are your people. We cast ourselves upon you. Hear us. We pray for Christ's sake.